What comes to mind when you think of confession? You might be feeling like, I'm afraid. What's the priest going to think of me? Or, since God loves me and forgives me, do I really need to tell my sins to a priest? Or maybe, if I go to confession, I'll feel awkward telling the priest everything, so maybe I should just wait. Well, it's time to understand that these distractions are keeping us away from the healing and saving graces that come from this incredible sacrament of reconciliation. Jesus loves to forgive us. He wants to reconcile us with our Father, a relationship broken through sin. Remember, reconciling our relationship with God was Jesus' idea in the first place. And since God created us, He knows what will really bring us peace. When we are set free from our burdens and are forgiven and healed, we can truly be joyful again. And after we shed our sins in the confessional, we'll feel like a 100-pound weight is lifted off. And the best part is that Jesus loves to forgive. He's anxious to forgive. Will we give Him that chance?
Celebrate with us Christ, to celebrate the risen Lord. It is a great privilege for a priest to be in a church that is holy. It is always there to celebrate with us the wonderfulness of the Eucharist. This is what this day is about. It's about the celebration of the risen Lord, what He has done for us. When we were going through these Easter ceremonies, there is a sense of lamentation. And of course, many of you, I hope, understand that word. It means sorrow. It means that we sing songs, things are a little bit subdued in many ways. Why? Because we are in a movement towards something. This lamentation that we do, you listen to the Psalms, and they're not as joyful. There's a lot of subduing, a lot about death and all that kind of stuff. And we listen to them. But then we come and to this particular day, and we hear a celebratory tone to everything. Everything has changed. Even in the Gospel. The Holy Spirit pours out from the Gospel in a wonderful way today. It uplifts us, all of us, hopefully, into the understanding that we are a privileged people. And I mean privileged. Because of our baptism, because of who we are, in united with Christ, we are His brothers and sisters. That's a great thing to be able to say. To be able to turn around and say that I'm a brother of Jesus Christ is an amazing thing. And to believe it is even better. Why? Because it uplifts us. It gives us a sense of where we're going. We live in a world that doesn't want us to know this. They don't want us to be happy. They want to give us things that decay. I mean, I look at my car. Yesterday, I get a couple of hours underneath it, trying to see if I fix it, you know? And it's a nice car. It's a Nissan. It's a good thing. But I need to fix it. It blew up in me the other day. Big puff of smoke. Here am I thinking that my car was going to go well. But it is a thing. Does it make me happy? Not really. In fact, it makes me sad because I keep putting money into it. It keep it going. So that's a sad thing. See? And that's what the Lord wants. The Lord wants you to believe that you have to have things, ideas, and places. Things that decay. Even the beautiful flowers that we have here before us will actually decay and die. They will rot. But we have something greater than that. We have the risen Christ, who is made present to us on this altar, in the Eucharist. He gives us himself as a gift, a perpetual gift of love and understanding. He tells us that if you follow my steps, baptize all nations. He doesn't stipulate, by the way, that it should be Catholics only. He said, all nations. We are all nations under God. One of the things that you see in your founding father, it says that. A nation under God. What a wonderful way to be able to say that your founding fathers had said a nation under God. And by the way, those men were not Catholics who wrote that particular thing. And yet at the same time they say a nation under God. They're fulfilling something. They're giving us a sense of belonging. That it's greater than the things of this world. But the Eucharist, what we will celebrate today, is even greater than that nation that we're talking about. It surpasses the nation because it gives us salvation. That's the difference. It gives us a sense of grace and love. And the Holy Spirit, I mean, if I could catch an idea of him, as St. Augustine talks about the Eucharist, he talks about the heavens are open, he says. And if you have filters on your eyes, you would see the angels ascending and descending, Christ ascending and descending as the sacrifice is being proclaimed. But our eyes are hidden, just like Mary Magdalene when she went to the tomb. Her eyes had been hidden from the reality of the risen Christ. He had to appear to them first, so that they notice that he is there. Tertullian tells us that the understanding of the risen Christ is that opening of the gates of paradise. Jesus went up to heaven, spent 3 days, we read our scriptures, he went down to hell, he released all those down in hell. And I love that particular movie, you know, The Passion of Christ, where that one teardrop falls from the sky, in a way. And you can watch it as it's coming down. Great cinematography, as they call it. And it comes right down, along, down, along, down. And as it's coming down, you can see the world. You can see it getting closer and closer and closer. The next thing you see Calvary, and it gets closer and closer and closer. And it passes by Christ like a speeding car. And it hits the ground. And immediately it hits the ground. The thing that we see is hell. The devil is beside it and he is screaming. He's not very happy. There's nobody there but himself. Why? Because through the passion of Christ, through his resurrection, everybody is released. That's the joy. That's the happiness. He said, I have been that sacrifice, that fully understanding of that sacrifice in you, with Christ. The Holy Spirit, the Father, and the Son come together in unity to bring us salvation. What a gift. And then we celebrate it with Easter Bunny. The only thing I ever knew that a bunny could lay an egg. Found that out when I was young. know, it's difficult to figure out how they manage it, but, you know, God can do it. I don't think he can do that one, but anyway. But that's it. We have secularized our Easter time. Instead of doing something about the risen Lord, we have Easter Bunny and candy. And of course, it is a time of joyfulness. That's why the candy is there. You know, you eat a lot of candy, you become very happy. Now, I remember when I was little. You know, if I didn't get 20 Easter eggs, I was very sad. I didn't have enough chocolate. You know, we all got chocolate. The fridge in the kitchen became the chocolate store. And everyone had their own little level. They put their own little chocolate in there. And dare anybody go in and take my chocolate. My chocolate would last me for about 3 weeks. On the other hand, my sister didn't. She just tore into the chocolate like there was no tomorrow. Not like my father. And if my father tore into my chocolate, I probably wouldn't have it either. But that was what we were given when we were young. And as I grew older, I began to look at it from a different perspective. The perspective of the Holy Spirit. That's why I'm standing here today. Why? Because of Christ. Not because of the chocolate and the Easter egg that I remember, but because of the Holy Spirit that filled me with the grace of God's love. Just like it did with Mary Magdalene and the Apostle, who went out and invited others to come. Come, join with us in the celebration of God. And it is a celebration. Christ is risen. Alleluia, alleluia. Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
It is here where you'll find the best marriage counselor, greatest healer, wisest teacher, and closest friend. It's a place where you'll escape the chaos of the world and find the lasting peace that only comes from God. Jesus is personally waiting to embrace you now with his divine mercy and healing love. Jesus is calling you home to his sacred heart today.
I need your mercy. I need a Savior.